back, and now he's waiting for us to come forth as sons of God. So creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. So just look at two scriptures quickly again. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. Let's just read it again. And Colossians 1:26. Now while you're turning there, on Old Year's Eve, I quoted the Eastern saying that said, if something seems impossible to reach, and you go one step further and you reach it, when you come back, you become the speaker. Okay, let's try and repeat it again. If something seems impossible to reach, and you take one step further and you reach it, when you come back after you've reached it, you become the speaker. What I'm trying to say is the world is waiting for somebody to come forth in the image of Christ Jesus. That is what creation is waiting for. Donkey Peter, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18.
And all of us, as with unveiled face, because we continue to behold in the Word of God as in a mirror.
Okay, listen. First, I want to put a few things down tonight. We behold something in the Word of God. And this Word of God is like a mirror, all right? And we behold something in that mirror, which is the Word of God. We're going to come back right in our last scripture. We're going to come back to this Word again. Right?
As in a mirror, the glory of the Lord are constantly being transfigured.
Okay, we are constantly being transfigured. Okay?
Into His very own image.
Into His very own image. Okay, as we behold in the Word, as in a mirror, we are constantly being transfigured. Another translation would say transformed. Okay, another translation would say changed. Depends on which one you've got on your lap. We are constantly being transfigured, transformed, changed into the very image of the Son of God. Okay? All right, go on.
In ever-increasing splendor and from one degree of glory to another.
Okay. And this transfiguration, this transformation, this changing is, if you've got the King James there, it'll say from glory to glory. Okay? So there's a glory that we receive when we are born again. There's a certain glory. Now, I don't want to go on before we read Colossians 1 quickly. Colossians 1:26.
The mystery of which was hidden for ages and generations from angels and men.
Okay, there's a mystery that's been hidden throughout history. Okay, and we've talked on that on Old Year's Eve and last Sunday, so I'm not going to touch on that. There's a mystery that's been hidden. Now it's been revealed, right?
But is now revealed to His holy people, to whom God was pleased to make known how great for the Gentiles are the riches of the glory.
Okay, listen first. There's a richness. The riches, okay? There's a richness. There are riches in a certain glory, right? Read.
Which is Christ.
Okay, there's a richness in the first glory. And that glory, the first glory equals Christ is in us. Okay?
Within and among you, the hope of glory.
Okay. Don't miss it. If that was it, then Christ would have already come. The world would have been saved by now. The devil would have been under our feet. But he's not yet under the feet of the church. He's not yet cast out of this world. He's still running rampant and still doing a lot of damage in the earth today. You can just switch your television on and see how much damage he's causing. But all the binding, all the losing, all the taking authority, all the gooing nachmal by die dorpers ingaan, don't get it done. So it's not in our labor and it's not in our works. I'm sorry to say it. I'll say it publicly on television. That will not get the thing done. Somebody's got to come forth in this glory. That glory is not doing the job. That is that first glory, Christ in us, is only the hope of the real glory. And if we look in the Word as in a mirror, in the presence and in the face of Jesus Christ, we are constantly changed. Little bit by little bit. By a little bit, we are transfigured, we are transformed, we are from this glory till we receive that glory. What does the Amplifier say?
From
Colossians
1:26. Colossians, he says, the mystery of which was hidden for ages and generations, but is now revealed to his holy people, to whom God was pleased to make known how great for the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ within and among you, the hope of realizing the glory.
Okay, so there's another glory. We read it in Old Year's Eve in another translation. That glory is yet to be revealed. This one is revealed. This one was hidden throughout the ages, but it's already been revealed. But this one is still to be revealed. Revealed comes from the word revelation, or goes to the word revelation. Okay, what is the revelation we're waiting for? John got the revelation of Jesus Christ and he gave it to the church. But the revelation the world is waiting for is for the sons of God to be made manifest. Somebody shout. So the sons of God, what is a son of God? A son of God is one in whom Christ has gained full stature. That is a true son of God. Now, 1 John 3:9 quickly in the King James. 1 John 3:9 just in the King James.
Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin.
Don't miss this. Don't miss this. If you are born again of God, there's a seed that is in you. Now he said, and he cannot sin. Because he is the one that's actually born of God. The Holy Spirit came upon Mary and she conceived. And the Bible says, the holy thing that will be born of you shall be called the Son of God. So the seed is Christ. How do I know that? Galatians 3 says, unto Abraham and his seed was the promises made. Not unto many seeds, but unto one seed, which is Christ. But verse 29 says, if we now belong to Christ, we are now the seed. You see, but first the seed is planted in us. So seed is Christ in us. The seed is the word. A sower sows the word. Word and seed. The word is the seed. The word became flesh, seed, as many as received him, the word. Unto them gave he power to become children. So if I receive Christ as my Savior, I take the seed of God in me. But seed means there must be growth. If I don't get seed to grow, it doesn't help me anything. A sack of seed in the barn doesn't help me. I've got to get the seed in the ground. I've got to get it watered. And the minute it grows, then people, oh, can I? But nobody looks at seed. Nobody, oh, check your sod. Hey, look at sod. How's more sod? People don't talk about seed. People talk about the plant. So what we need is a growth in the seed. So the seed has been planted in us when we were born again. And that is the first glory, which is Christ is in us. Amen. Now the growth will take us from glory to glory. So we get to a place. In Galatians 2, verse 20 says, it's no longer I that liveth, but it's now Christ in me. That's why Paul goes on to Galatians 4:19. My beloved children, for who I am in travail again, till Christ be formed in you. So Paul says, I'm in travail again the second time. The first time I was in travail to get you born again, to get the seed planted in you, because you've got to be in travail to give birth. So my first travailing for you, Galatians, was to get the first glory in you. So that is a hope. But now I'm in travail again, so that Christ will now be formed in you. I want you to grow. And that is Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1. Let us go on to perfection, and not again lay the foundations of the first principles of Christ. So it's not, we can't every Sunday push the people to be born again. So people wear their born againers out. Because every Sunday, everybody must be born again. But what we're heading for is Christ must be formed in us. Where I can say, it's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. And the life I now live, I live to the glory of God the Father. So what are we doing? It doesn't help. We just preach nice sermons every Sunday. Somehow we must know that what is the plan, what is the purpose that God has for you. And I tell you, for years I've been standing alone to preach this message, because people really start talking about you when you say this, because you say, they say, you are now bringing heaven to earth. That's exactly what we're doing. We're bringing heaven to earth. Let thy will be done in heaven, on earth as it is in heaven. We want the heavenly things to start happening on earth. And Christ died for this specific purpose. And I tell you, he's not coming before people are coming forth in the very image of Christ. Put up your hands, say, Lord, I want it. This is where I'm going to. This is what I'm going to reach. In Jesus' name. Right, go to Matthew 17. Today, a total different route. I want Peter, just go to Genesis 2 and Exodus 31 quickly. You don't have to go there. Peter's going to read it for us.
Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day...
Okay, listen to this. On the seventh day...
God.
Man, hier gaan ons nou 'n ding vat vandag. I tell you, I'm going to touch on something that I don't know if people are prepared to touch, but we're going to touch it. On the seventh day.
God ended his work.
Okay. Which God stopped working.
Which he had done.
God stopped working. Okay.
And he rested on the seventh
day. And what did God do on the seventh day? He rested. Now, I don't know, but I know that all of you have heard that God rested on the seventh day. And then what God did God do with the day when he rested? He blessed it.
From all the work which he'd done. And God blessed, okay. Spoke good of the seventh day.
God blessed the seventh day. God blessed the seventh day. God rested and God blessed it. Right. Exodus 31. What has this got to do with the sons of God? Exodus 31, verse 12 through 17, Peter, King James Version.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you.
Okay, you shall keep my Sabbath. You shall keep my Sabbath, right?
For it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations.
It's a sign, right?
That ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. Ye shall keep the Sabbath therefore, for it is holy unto you. Every one that defileth it shall surely be put to death. For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among his people. 6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed.
Oh. That's the same word.
Amen.
As restored. Uh-huh. That's the same word there as revived. Now listen. God says the Sabbath day, which is the seventh day, will be a sign. It'll be holy unto the Lord. In 6 days, you can work. But on the seventh day, if you work, you'll be killed, man. So don't work on the seventh day. Now, we've taken that according to the Levitical laws. And we've got an image of the 6 days of God's work, and how the children of Israel had to gather manna in the desert. And we take the seventh day as Sabbath, as the day where they rested. And we thought that this was God's idea of a Sabbath rest. Nobody touches anything. That was a Levitical law that was given to help the children of Israel to gain strength to come into the promised land. But God has got a total different view of this. So God blessed the seventh day. God was refreshed on the seventh day. God was revived on the seventh day. But 6 days of work. What does he mean and what is he trying to tell us? Matthew 17. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, and brought them up into a high mountain apart. And he was transfigured before them, and his face did shine. Now listen to this. How many remember what happened when in our first scriptures, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, where it says, as we behold in a face, we are changed from glory to glory. We are, what did we read? We are transfigured. We are transformed. Now Jesus, 6 days passed. On the seventh day, Jesus was transfigured. On the seventh day, Jesus was transfigured. His face started to shine. He took on a total different apparel. His clothes started shining. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he yet spoke, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, this is my beloved Son. When he was transfigured, the voice said, this is now my Son. This is now my Son. Then he said something else. Hear him. Now remember, Hebrews 1, verse 1 through 3 says, God who at sundry times and divers manners spoke to the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by the Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, which is the brightness of his glory. So Jesus Christ, the brightness of the glory of God, was transfigured on the seventh day on a high mountain, declared the Son, and God said, now this is the one you must hear. But now listen to verse 9. And they came down from the mountain. And as they came down from, Jesus charged them, saying, tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead. This vision must not be told before the resurrection. This vision must not be told. Why? Because the mystery that's been hidden throughout the ages has only now been revealed. Christ can now be in us. The Son of God, the Spirit. And God has poured out the Spirit of His Son in our hearts. Romans 8, Galatians 4. Crying, Abba, Father. And if that is true, then we are heirs, joint heirs with Christ. Heirs of the Most High God. So this whole mystery, Jesus said, you've seen it, but don't say it. But if I am resurrected, this vision, you can tell it. But more than tell it, you can live it. Amen. In John chapter 12, the Greeks came and said, we want to see Jesus. He said, no, I'm not showing today. He said, a grain of corn must first fall in the ground and die. Then it'll bear much fruit. Yeah. Exodus 24. Exodus 24, verse 15. And Moses went up into the mountain. Remember, Moses appeared there with Jesus. And Moses went up into the mountain. And a cloud covered the mountain. And the glory of the Lord abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered the mountain for 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire. So listen here. For six days, the glory was there. The glory was there. For 6 days, the glory was already hanging there. But on the seventh day, God said, now come to glory. On the seventh day, he said, now Moses, you've now seen the glory from the outside. You're on the mountain. Now I want you to come in to the glory. The glory was there for 6 days. But now it's time to get into the glory. So on the seventh day, on the Sabbath day, which is called the day of rest. So we're going to get a total different idea of what God is calling rest. There's a song that they sing, so rise to your rest and be blessed by our praise as your glory fills this place. Oh, the glory of your presence. We, your people, give you reverence. Come and rise to your rest. The Bible doesn't say from your rest. Rise to your rest. So God, stand up and come to your rest. Come to your resting place. What is that? Let your glory now fill this place. 6 days glory. So the Sabbath is the seventh day. God said it's a holy day. God rested, God blessed it, God was refreshed. God was revived himself. Jesus on the seventh day was transfigured, called the Son of God. He said, don't tell this before after the resurrection.
That's right. Yeah.
Moses for 6 days saw the glory, but on the seventh day went into the glory.
Yeah.
And God calls that the rest. Now, what does God think of this? Luke chapter 4. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And he closed the book and gave it again to the minister and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Jesus, on the seventh day, help me, on the seventh day, which is the Sabbath day, went into the synagogue and he declared, I am anointed. The word anointed is Christ. I am now Christ. I was Jesus till now. Everybody called me Jesus. Mama called me Jesus. Joseph called me Jesus. James called me Jesus. Peter called me Jesus. But now I've been baptized. I've been filled with the Spirit. God spoke, said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. I went to the desert for 40 days. I was tempted of the devil 3 times. The same temptation. If you are the Son of God, say to these stones. If you are the Son of God, jump down. If you are the Son of God. So I'm just coming back to declare. On the seventh day, I want to make a declaration. I will not make it on the sixth day. I will not make it on the fifth, the fourth, or the third day. I'm making this declaration on the day of rest, on the Sabbath day, on the day that God has holied, on the day that God has blessed, on the day that God has brought revival, on the day that God was refreshed. On this day, I want to declare, I am now Christ. And what I want to say, what will be fulfilled in this seventh day, I want you to know what will be fulfilled on the seventh day. This day, this scripture is fulfilled. So on this day, I'm going to set them free. I'm going to heal them. I'm going to get them saved. I'm going to bind up the brokenhearted. I'm going to loose them from the devil. And this seventh day, this is fulfilled. Turn around to Luke chapter 6. Also verse 1. Let's take this one in the Amplified. One Sabbath, while Jesus was passing through the fields of standing grain, it occurred that his disciples picked some of the spikes and ate of the grain. Now remember, Exodus said they're not allowed to do anything on the Sabbath day. Rubbing it out with their hands. But some of the Pharisees, that's the other Okies that knows the scriffies, actually. But some of the Pharisees asked them, why are you doing what is not permitted to be done on the Sabbath day? But Jesus was there. He knew the law. So why did he allow them, but Moses would not have allowed them? The Levitical law didn't allow it. But that wasn't God's first intention with the seventh day of rest. So Jesus said, hey, mana, like you like, oma, pluck for the quorum. And say, hey, whoa, 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 this is not permitted. And Jesus replied, verse 3, saying, have you never so much as read what David did when he was hungry? He and those who were with him. Now he's talking about David. He's talking about David. Now I want you to know, David was the seventh son. He's talking about David. He said, don't you know what David did when he was hungry? He and those who were with him. How he went into the house of God and took and ate the sacred loaves of showbread, which is not permitted for anyone except only the priests to eat. And also gave to those who were with him. I mean, hierdie ou maak oorlog. Hy gaan eet al die brood wat die priesters moet eet. Uit die heiligdom uit op die sewende dag. Die Sabbatdag. Verse 5. And he said to them, listen what Jesus is saying. The Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath. And it occurred on another Sabbath that when he went into the synagogue and taught, a man was present whose right hand was withered. And the scribes and the Pharisees kept watching Jesus to see whether he would actually heal on the Sabbath, in order that they might get some ground or accusation against him. But he was aware all along of their thoughts. And he said to the man with the withered hand, come and stand here in the midst. And he arose and stood there. Then Jesus said to them, I ask you, is it lawful? Now listen what he's saying. Is it lawful? I mean, they on the law. The law says it's not permitted. Jesus said, is it lawful? Is it lawful? And right, on the Sabbath to do good, so that someone derives advantage from it, or to do evil, to save a life and make a soul safe, or to destroy it. Then he glanced around at them all and said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he did so, and his hand was fully restored like the other one. What happened to his hand? It was restored. When was his hand restored? On the seventh day. Why was it restored on the seventh day? Because on the seventh day, Jesus said, this day the scripture is fulfilled that I am now Christ, which is the Son. And on the Sabbath day, this scripture is fulfilled. I will now set them free. I will now heal them. I will now save them. I will now lose them. It's fulfilled. Turn around to chapter 13. Verse 10, King James. And he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath day. And behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity 18 years and was bowed together and could in no wise lift up herself. When Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. And the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation, because that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath day, and said to the people, there are 6 days in which men ought to work. In them therefore come and be healed, and not on the Sabbath day. The Lord then answered him and said, you hypocrite, do you not on the Sabbath day loose your ox or your donkey and lead him away to water? ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan hath bound 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day? Listen, he's now loosing a woman of what he said is fulfilled. They said, oh, no. If you want to work, you must work 6 days. So if you want to heal people, heal them in 6 days. Don't do it on the Sabbath day. Jesus said, do you lose your donkey? Standing there at the pole and you see he's thirsty and you come from the synagogue. Do you lose your donkey and take him to water? They say, yeah. He said, why must I not lose this woman? She's been bound now for 18 years. But you lose your donkey, but you will not lose a woman. You will lose your cattle to go drink, but you will not lose a woman. 14. Luke 14. Kan jy wel geen iets sien hierso? And it came to pass as he went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath day, that they watched him, and behold, there was a certain man before him which had dropsy. And Jesus answered, spake unto the lawyers and Pharisees, saying, you must listen to whom he speaks. Listen to what he says. Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? And they held their peace and took him and healed him and let him go. They held their peace. Jesus took him, healed him, and let him go. Jesus took him, healed him, and he set him free on the Sabbath day. And they held their peace and took him. And verse 5, and Jesus answered, and he said to them, which of you have a donkey or an ox that falls into a pit will not immediately pull him out on the Sabbath day? And they could not answer him. So I don't know if you see this, but it seems to me like God's idea of the seventh day, which is called Sabbath, which is called rest, is totally different than the idea which the Jews had. They had an idea, sit still and like to do it as you can. Don't move. But I will lose my donkey, I will lose my cattle, I will let them, but I will not do anything to people. Jesus came on the scene. He said, did you know what the seventh day was made for? This is the rest. It's on the seventh day that God called Moses into glory. It's on the seventh day that Jesus was transfigured on the Mount of Transfiguration, glorified on the seventh day. So the seventh day is a day of glory, a day of signs, a day of wonders, a day of miracles. The seventh day is the day of God's power. Jesus did most of his miracles on Sabbath days. Not so much to irritate the Pharisees, that was just a byproduct. But to bring into realization and into fulfillment God's idea of the seventh day. Let's jump back to Joshua. Chapter 6. Joshua. Joshua. Now Joshua was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out, none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, Joshua 6, see, I have given into thy hand Jericho, and the king thereof, and the mighty men of valor. And ye shall compass the city, all ye men of war, and go round about the city once. Thus shall you do for 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear the ark, 7 trumpets of ram's horns. And the 7th day you shall compass the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow with the trumpets. Now listen, they could walk on the 6th day, but they were not allowed to walk on the 7th day. God says, man, I want you on the 7th day to walk 7 times. I want this down, written down in history, so that somehow, somewhere in the future, somebody will get the revelation and stand up and tell my people what I really meant when I said rest, peace, holy, seventh Sabbath. So Joshua, do it. But I'm going to write it down, and somehow in the future somebody will read Bible and say, my goodness, what's this? I mean, this was Israelites. They're not supposed to walk. So God said, no, I don't want you to walk on the seventh day. I want you to walk seven times on the seventh day. Listen. And it shall come to pass, verse 5, that when they make a long blast with a ram's horn, remember, seven priests blowing seven horns, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall down flat. But there's not something supposed to happen on the Sabbath day. And the people shall ascend up every man straight before him. Verse 15. And it came to pass on the seventh day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and compassed the city after the same manner seven times. Only on that day they compassed it seven times. And it came to pass at the seventh time, when the priest blew the trumpets, Joshua said unto the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Verse 27. So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame was noised throughout the country. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. So now we got David there, and we got Joshua there. We got David and we got Joshua. So let's listen to the sweet psalm writer. Psalm 92. What does your Bible say on the top of that psalm? Lees hom hardop.
A song of the seventh day.
A psalm or a song for the
Sabbath.
So this was written especially, explicitly, on purpose for the Sabbath day. This was not written to be sung on the sixth day. This song was written to sing on the seventh day. It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High, to show forth thy loving kindness in the morning and thy faithfulness every night. Upon an instrument of 10 strings, and upon the psaltery, upon the harp with a solemn sound. For thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the works of thy hands. But you're not supposed to work. How can you triumph on the works on the Sabbath day? O Lord, how great are thy works! How great are thy thoughts! This is for the Sabbath day, not for the sixth day. You're supposed to work 6 days, but they, oh God, how great is our works on the Sabbath day. Verse 8, but thou, Lord, art most high forevermore. For lo, verse 9, thine enemies, O Lord, for lo, thine enemies shall perish. All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. But this is for the Sabbath day. Which day did Joshua do it? On the seventh day. What does the psalm writer says? When will the enemies be scattered? On the seventh day. But mine horn shalt thou exalt like the horn of a unicorn. I shall be anointed. I shall be anointed. When shall I be anointed? On the seventh day. I shall be anointed with fresh oil. Mine eye also shall see my desire on mine enemies. My ear shall hear my desire of the wicked that rise up against me. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. That means they shall be anointed and they shall keep on growing and keep on bearing fruit. If you read Galatians 5, there's a vast difference between the work of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. It's not the work of the Spirit, it's the fruit of the Spirit. John 15, I'm the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. If you abide in me, and I abide in you, you shall bear much fruit. So it's not working for fruit, it's abiding for fruit. Abide means rest. Stay. Be quiet. It's not works of the Spirit, it's fruit of the Spirit. It's not fruit of the flesh, it's work of the flesh. But we know, Peter says, one day, as is 1,000 years. 1,000 years is as one day. Since Adam came on the scene, 6 days have passed. We have now entered the seventh day. So till now, this could not have happened. That's why the church is still in restoration times. So we're heading for the restoration of all things. And the pinnacle point is the sons of God will come to the front. The enemies will be put under their feet. God will come to his rest. Psalm 95. Psalm, just turn around to Psalm 95. Now remember, we've got David and Joshua there. Listen to what David says. Harden not your heart, as in the provocation, as in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my work. 40 years long I was grieved with this generation, and said, it is a people that do err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. Unto whom I swear in my wrath, they should not enter into my rest. God said, for 40 years they were touring around in the desert, but I said to them, not one of you shall enter into my rest. Calling rest. Where were they heading to? They were not heading to rest. They were heading for Canaan. So God says, you will not enter my rest. But they're not heading to rest. They're heading to take over another land. And God says, but you will not get into my rest. Have you ever heard the saying, there's a place in God? Hebrews 4. Remember now Matthew 17, Transfiguration. Today this is fulfilled. Luke 4. Verse 1. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest. We've got a promise to enter the rest. Any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached to them did not profit them, because it was not mixed with faith to them that heard it. For we which have believed do enter into rest. As he said, I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation. They shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day. God spoke of the seventh day on this wise. And God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest. Seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached enter not in because of unbelief. Again he limited a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart. Now listen carefully. You must read Acts with us. David didn't get the fulfilling. He was still a prophet. But God, have you ever heard of limited editions? They make cars and say, that's a limited edition, so there's only a certain amount made and it's worth more than the others. You buy a guitar and it says limited edition. God limited a certain day. And he spoke through David on that day. And he said, there will be a day when you hear his voice, you must not harden your heart in that day. For that day will be the true day of God's rest. Look at chapter 3, verse 8. Verse 7 says, therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts, as happened in the rebellion and their provocation and embitterment of me in the day of testing, where your fathers tried me and tested me and found I stood their test, and they saw my works for 40 years. So I provoked, displeased, and sorely grieved with that generation. I said, they always err. So God said, they will not, verse 11, enter into my rest. But verse 8 in chapter 4 says, for if Jesus have given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? Yeah. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his works as God did from his. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God, remember, we started off with the word. The very first thing I said today, remember, I will come back at the end. The word. For the word of God is quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, of the joints and the marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart.
Amen.
God limited a certain day and said, in that day, my rest will only start breaking through. On that day, I will be anointed. Anointing means Christ. Christos, Greek, means anointed. Mashiach, Hebrew, means anointed. So on the seventh day, the sons of God will come to the front. What will the sons of God do? They will set people free. They will heal people. They will get them saved. They will loose them. The power of God is ready to be released like never before in people that are prepared to say, I will enter into the rest. I will realize the seventh day has finally arrived. 6 days have passed where people have labored, people have worked. And I can call it to you in Revelation chapter 13. It says, many have labored, but they have now died, but the works now follow. John chapter 4, Jesus said in 38, he says, others have labored, but I will send you into the labors to just gather the fruit. Hebrews 12 says, seeing that we've got so great a cloud of witnesses round and about them, those are those that have labored. So for 6 days, they have labored. On the seventh day, we're the most privileged people on the earth. I hope you can see. We can now come forth in the image of Christ, and we can just walk into their labors. We don't have to do the labor. We can just walk in and just gather the harvest. We can just stretch our hands and get the sick healed. Come on, people. We have seen miracles, but I said it last week. When the 74th, it's 76 plus that two of last week with the walkers. 76 people threw crutches and walkers away in 18 months. Yeah. That's more than in the 20 years that I'm in the ministry. In 18 months, I've seen more miracles than in 20 years. If they come here with a crutch, they go out with a crutch, without a crutch. They come here with a kiri, they go out without a kiri. It's like, hey, God, what is happening? He says, well, you're just entering my rest, my son. Entering into the rest means you accepting sonship. You're not prepared to labor as a child. You're prepared to rest as a son. You're not ready to work as a slave, for I have not called you servants anymore. John 15. But I've called you friends. For a servant does not know what his master doeth. But Galatians 4 says, we are no longer slaves, but sons.
Amen.
And if sons, then heirs of God. Yeah. Joint heirs with Christ. not with Jesus, with Christ, with the anointing, with the power, the signs, the wonders, the miracles. Creation waits for Christ to come to the front. The man Jesus Christ walked this earth 2,000 years ago. But Christ is ready to be revealed in you and me. So the creation is waiting for somebody to say, I will take it. I'm not going to harden my heart now. I'm not going to keep on working to prove something. I'm going to say, wow, Christ in me is the hope of the real glory. But the hope is already rich in glory. But there's another glory, which is the fullness of the Christ in me. Remember the vision? The dream that I dreamt in 96? Just quickly for those who haven't seen it. Two gates. With the creation, the whole creation there on that side of the gate. On this side, multitudes of people standing. And they're pushing against this gate. And the dream said, any revelation can be preached out. Once it's preached, it can be caught anywhere in the world.
Yeah.
So if I preach a revelation now, Kenneth Copeland can catch it in America. If Kenneth Copeland preached a revelation there, I can catch it here. Because it's in the spirit world. And if I'm in the spirit, I can catch it. But there's one revelation that can never be preached out. It must be lived out.
Amen.
And that is a revelation of the sons of God.
Yes.
So you can preach on this. I can preach on that. But before someone comes to the front, people will not say son of God. They will say it's a good teaching. It's a good teaching. But once the miracles will flow even more like it's flowing now. Once the dead start being raised. And with that is a lot of other things. It's the whole Sabbath day thing that must come into fulfillment. And God said, and I was here in the front pushing. And when I broke through, the gates were opened. And when the gates opened, multitudes that followed suit and broke through. Forget what you've learned in religion. Start getting into the Word. Because the Word of God is quick and powerful. It'll cut through your soul and your spirit. And it'll tell you what was soulish and what is spiritual. Get this fleshly thing, the soulish thing out. Get the spiritual thing in. Enter into that rest. Listen to the voice of Almighty God. Don't harden your heart. And you will come forth on the seventh day as a son of the Most High God. Let's stand and give Him some praise. Hallelujah.
Come on, stand.
You are the stone of the builders rejected.
The sure rock of our foundation upon which we are built. And Lord, there may be those that have rejected you, but we declare in this place tonight that we accept you. We accept you because we realize without you we are nothing, we have nothing. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh. You are the stone that the builders rejected, a rock of refuge where my pride is broken, a sure foundation when the sand is sinking, where we are built upon like living stones. There is no one else like you, there is no one like you, Lord, there is no one else like you. Some hell conspired to make you captive, but every chain of sin and death you've broken and triumphed over by your mighty power. There is no one else like you, there is no one like you, Lord. Sharing the suffering of the cross,
for which you've called me to be with you, Son of Man, Son of God.
To be with you,
to be with you, Son of Man, Son of God.
And from the earth you to the heights ascended, where you are seated at the Father's right hand, forever pleading for the souls you've captured, forever watching as you call us
son. There is no one else like you, there is no one like you, Lord. There is no one else like you, Son of Man and Son of God, Son of Man and Son of God.